Okay, so now Russell's a part of it. Now you got Rick and you got Russell. And now like they just went for it. And it's crazy how quickly, well, I guess cuz hip hop was such a small culture at the time, they got to the top within like a year.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, and they're still, this is all out of Rick's dorm room.
Yeah.
Like, it's crazy. And who was first to have a record on Def Jam? Was it LL or was it the Beastie Boys?
Well, they were with Russell, so I would say them. I would say it's the Beastie Boys before LL, right? Because they were like actually with Rick, right? They were like Rick's
Yeah.
act. So, the first record, I don't know. Let's Google it. No, I'm just kidding.
No, we got encyclopedias in our minds.
Yeah, it. I'm gonna say LL.
Yeah.
I'm gonna go with him.
Yeah. And this was another interesting story that I heard, and it's like the difference between like how a rich person thinks and a poor person thinks. 'Cause I heard a story that one of like LL's first music videos, he showed up wearing like all this jewelry and shit.
His heroes were like Grandmaster Flash and Melly Mel and stuff
Yeah,
like that.
yeah.
So if you think about the way they used to dress,
Yeah.
LL showed up like that with like thigh-high boots and everything.
So like we have a young like 18-year-old LL who's just like trying to stunt. He shows up wearing all this jewelry, the big chains and the rings and shit. And Rick
No, he's
Rubin.
wearing like leather and like a Grandmaster look. He's looking like almost like Afrika Bambaataa. You know what I'm saying? Like he might as well had a long feather on his hair. He probably
Yeah.
got leather and like almost looking like an urban cowboy. That's how
Yeah.
LL showed up.
Well, what they were saying in the story that I heard is that for one music video, he showed up just like all blinged out, just everything. And
Okay.
Rick was just like, don't wear that. Rick was like, why do you need that?
Yeah.
And LL's like, well, I want people to know I'm doing good. And Rick was just kind of like, you do good enough, you don't need that shit.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And
Yeah.
that was like a story. And apparently LL was so like adamant that he wanted to wear all his jewelry. He went up to Russell and was like, yo, Russell, what the fuck? Like, Rick doesn't want me wearing this shit. And Russell was just like, listen to Rick. Like, Rick knows what he's talking about.
Yeah, and that became a good image for LL because that's all you think about. I think about old school LL Cool J with like a polo shirt, jeans, a Kango, and just like one rope chain. When Bigger and Deafer came out though, he had like the two he had the four finger rings. He had to have that on, but he wasn't all jeweled up. Never. He was kind of It's not clean cut, but hip hop clean cut, if you could say. Yeah, so I guess he did listen to
But I
Rick.
just thought that was really interesting because, and then now he says, he's like, looking back, Rick was totally right.
Yeah, because, well, he just seems like an excessive guy because he shows up for the audition with the whole Grandmaster Flash outfit. And then Russell's like, hell no. And then he shows up for his video with all the chains and stuff. It just seems like that's his personality, you know?
So LL put out his record, it was huge. And then, okay, so we got to talk about the Beastie Boys. So the Beastie Boys, I think one of them was from Manhattan, the other two were from Brooklyn, something like that.
Yeah, definitely all from the city though.
They're all from the city. They met up with Rick, and they were a punk band.
Yeah.
Again, this is kind of similar to Rick. Like, they were a straight up punk band,
Yeah.
but they were around, and they were, I don't want to say in the streets necessarily, but they were around. They knew what was going on. They knew
Yeah.
about hip hop,
Yeah.
and they fucking loved it. And it was the same thing. Like, they kind of recognized like hip hop and punk rock, it's like one of the same. So they kind of like started like expanding and like going into hip hop a little more. And then their first record, License to Ill, I believe went number one. And this is something I didn't know until recently. I thought that maybe like Rick, like once this all got big, like I didn't even know that he finished college. Like in my head, I was just like, oh, like you're running a record label? Fuck that. What do you need college for? But apparently he stayed and finished college while this is all happening. And this entire time, Def Jam Records headquarters was in his dorm room until he graduated.
Yeah.
So literally they're making number one records out of this man's dorm room.
Yeah.
It's fucking insane.
It is insane, but that's New York radio for you. You know what I mean? Or lots of radio. You climb the charts and you're still broke. You know, there's many, many artists. Like even Mary J. Blige was like, Real Love was on the radio and I was still walking up the hill to the projects. Like it's just crazy. But that's just how it happens. I'm glad he finished college because telling from him and his personality is probably around a lot of naysayers. You know what I mean? Like, what you gonna do? You're gonna run a record label? Yeah, that's what you gonna, you know what I mean? So not only that, he proved them wrong with that, but then he got his degree so he could pretty much stunt on those same motherfuckers, like, you know.
I'm just saying, like, that's low key so genius.
Yeah,
like that's genius level something to pull off. Like, you're literally founding a record label that you're putting out number one records. Like, first of all, how many people ever can say that you founded a record label with a record that went to number one?
Right.
Not many people.
Right.
So he did all of that while still taking classes and still doing well enough to graduate.
Yeah.
Like, that's insane.
Yeah.
That blew my mind. I didn't know that until recently.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He's definitely. Oh, one for the books, that Rick Rubin. But I know he did that. It had to be, because he's like, I'm probably going to end up in rooms with a bunch of, like, really intellectual people.
Yeah.
And the first thing they ask you when you try to prove a point that's against somebody else's point, where'd you go to school?
Nowhere.
No.
Florida State. Yeah, so it's just really cool how that happened, because, again, like, before Def Jam, hip-hop was a very local thing. But then now you got a number one record in the nation.
Yeah.
So clearly this is bigger than it was before Def Jam got their hands on it, if you will.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, they really took it from, like, a local street level kind of thing into business.
Yeah, it's super, super local. And yeah, anybody... You know, sometimes, like, New York people have, like, an arrogant mind. And then a lot of us were like, if you came before Def Jam, like, who are you? Like, you know what I mean? Like, that is dinosaur music. Like, we thought like that, you know, almost to the point where even, like, if you were Run DMC, that was too far back. Like, you know what I mean? Just like, whoa.
That's interesting.
Like, yeah, because, like, no offense, but because I'm just speaking from a young person's mind state, right? Like, a person in school.
Say it.
By the time people like Nas and DMX came out, didn't nobody want to hear about no Run DMC?
Yeah.
Nobody wanted to hear about that. Like, honest to goodness. They had a song where they had some type of resurgence in, like, 91. I think Pete Rock and CL Smooth remixed Down With The King. And that was good, but that was about it. Like, Run was already irreverent. He was already going the other way. Yeah. And that was back in the day where... If you lasted like 3-4 years, you were like a legend. Exactly. Because so think about it. Like, by the time it was 91, you're talking about Run DMC, who started in what, 84, maybe even before that, in the 70s and stuff. They were with each other and stuff. But when they became like super, super solid and came under the Def Jam label, you think like by the time 91 came, they were already played out. Mm. And you think about that with somebody like Jay-Z, who's been around since like 95, 94, right. And it's 2021.
Right.
And Jay-Z's technically not played out. Like, you know what I mean?
Debatable.
Yeah. Well,
well numbers wise. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. No, you know what I'm saying? People still consider him, you know, somebody worth talking about. Yeah, yeah. And like kids that are rappers today will rate him. Like, you know what I'm saying? They'll have his album and be like, oh yeah, this is one of my, you know, this is one of my good songs. But like in 1991, you didn't have like the Run DMC albums. Like, this is a lyricist, right? Like, you know what I mean?
Right. Well, we did an episode on Biggie lately, and it's like, in my head, it's like the era of Run and the era of Biggie never crossed. You know what I mean? And we're not talking about a long time in between.
No.
We're talking about mid-80s to early 90s. Yeah. And it's like the whole culture was completely different.
Yeah, because, I mean, I put Run DMC in like 84, 85. That's when it was like marketing huge. Where it's like the logo. Like, I just had on a shirt yesterday. Broadway Dance Center made a t-shirt after Run DMC's logo. You know what I'm saying? So that, like, Fruity Pebbles had rope chains and Barney was rapping. Like, that was Run DMC. The hats with the gazelles and the rope chain and the Adidas.
Yeah.
That's like 84, 85. So that's when I want to say that they like peaked and they were like a worldwide phenomenon.